Okay, so what did we do in the last class? I believe we have looked at the stability analysis, isn't it? Let's briefly see what we have learned in the last class, and then we'll move ahead. So in the last class, in the last class, we looked at stability analysis for two different sets of equation. One is for the one-dimensional uncertainty equation. Next is first order wave equation. Okay, we have second derivatives here and we have first order derivatives here. That's the main difference. What we did was we selected an error function epsilon. We said that the ratio of epsilon plus one time step to epsilon at nth time step will give us a measure of how the rounding off errors are changing over time. We call this factor as amplification factor, and we are trying to see the modulus of this or argument, what do you say, the magnitude of this amplification factor. So when we did it for when we applied this forward in time and center in space to this equation, wave equation, what we got was it was unconditionally unstable. That is, we got 1 plus some value. Okay. I believe I have shown you the plot as well. Like we can do this thing in manually in plotting software, because we know that from this we know that Km delta x is varying from minus pi to pi. And so we already know we have fixed the range for x, and we can set the ratio C delta T over delta X as CFL number. That's what we have seen. That's the most important parameter in CFD, because it determines the scheme stability. Okay, so here, this is firstly for the unstable scheme. Let's see how it looks like. Okay, let's run it. We can either solve it, or we can directly plug in the solution, and we can vary this x over minus pi to pi. That's what I've done here. That is Km delta x. And for a given CFL, we can see. So for all the ranges of CFL number, that is from 0 to 1, 0 to 1 CFL numbers, all the values of this amplification factor lie above, just above 1. Okay. So we see that this is an unstable scheme. If these points lie in the circle and on the circle, we can say that the scheme is stable and the error is in the bounds of minus 1 to 1. We are plotting imaginary G versus real. Okay, so your points of G should, whatever we are calculating, should fall in between or on this circle for the scheme. This forwarding and center in space, we observe that this scheme is unconditionally unstable. We can, whatever we do, doesn't matter. End of the day, this is going to be an unstable scheme. We came up with a clever solution. Okay, he said that let me he just changed this UIN in this term, UIN, that is second term, and he said this is plus. I still need to correct it, I guess. Before uploading, I'll correct it. Half of it's an average between two points, UI plus one and UI minus one. That's an approximation that he's doing, or to be specific, it's interpolation. Okay, this should be plus. I'll change it. This should be plus. Okay. After he has done that, he found out that amplification factor is now this, and this is found to be stable if the C delta T delta X is less than or equal to 1 and lies between 0 to 1. So I've denoted sigma to be the CFL number or the ratio of dt over dx times the wave speed. Okay, let's run this and see. So we can see here that for all the ranges of CFL numbers from 0 to all the whatever amplification factor we're getting, it's lying on and inside the circle. That means that this scheme is stable if the CFL number is lying between 0 and 1. Okay, let's see it only for 0.2 CFL. Let's only check it for only one CFL number. How it looks like. So for every CFL number, we get an ellipse within the circle, and it is well in, so the error is quite low. So when we are comparing multiple schemes, okay, there is something much more to this amplification factor. Hopefully we'll get to look at it in the next chapter, where we are looking at diffusion and dispersion and numerical dissipation and numerical dispersion errors. Okay, so the amount of error also matters. Okay, and this error will also translate into the physics. Okay, we'll look at it later on. So we say that within this circle of unit radius, then we are good and this scheme is stable and the errors are bound. So that's the first thing. Okay, this is for CFL number of 0.2. So Peter Lacks modified this FTCS and it came up with a new scheme. Fine. And if the CFL is 1.2, let's see if C delta T or delta X, if it is greater than 1, what will happen? Okay, as you can see here, most of the points lie outside the circle. Okay, this ellipse is now grown bigger than this circle. Okay, this ellipse has grown less than this circle, and above CFL number of 1.0, this scheme also will be unstable. So CFL number is generally between 0 and 1. So you cannot take, even if you are using Peter Lacks method, your CFL number or C delta T or delta X should be lying between 0 and 1. Since we have a condition under in which this scheme is stable, we are calling this scheme to be Peter Lacks scheme to be, we have assessed the scheme to be conditionally stable. Okay, on some conditions, it is stable. So that's what, so in our practical applications, we have to set our delta T. Okay, we have to set our delta T time step for a given grid. Say you have a complex grid and you can find out your delta X. You can find out the smallest delta X and you can compute your delta T. Okay, that is one way of finding it. You get a delta T which is the smallest in all the at all the points. Okay, even if delta X is varying, at some place delta T could be 0.5, some places delta T could be 0.1. But we will take the minimum delta T called as global minimum, and we will apply that and we will run our CFD simulations. So people who don't get this will give, so they will be guessing this delta T all the time. Instead of simply using CFL criteria to compute it, they will simply randomly guess this delta T and they will waste a lot of their own time. So this current number or CFL number is a very, very important number in CFD. It's more or like, there is no comparison, but yeah, numerical methods in fluid dynamics, current number is one of the most important number. So when we look at it in physical terms, say for example at point I, there is a wave moving to the right and to the left at some velocity A. So what is the distance it travels in some delta T time step? It is A times delta T. That is, velocity is distance over time. Distance is velocity times time. So this is what it is, velocity times time, how much time has progressed. So this wave has traveled A delta T and it is still has not crossed this point B, that is I plus 1, and this hasn't crossed point A, that is I minus 1. So what is happening here is, before this wave travels this point B, okay, in the next iteration we'll assume that this wave is at B and we'll continue the solution. Okay, the solution here in this region will be dependent on this characteristic wave. Okay, this is when, so we are assuming that this delta X or equal to a delta t, then we are fine. Okay, that is nothing but a delta t over delta x is less than or equal to 1. That's nothing but your CFL condition. Hence, the scheme will be stable because the next point we will take this wave and so on. What happens if you take CFL greater than 1? This wave has already crossed point B. Before you compute this slope is at B, it is not going to see from that greater than delta x. So that's why numerically also speaking, this is how the CFL number looks. Okay, I think this is for the second order wave equation where you have some characteristics and with some slopes which are progressing in time space. But the simplest explanation is this, that the wave has already traveled this point, across this point B, and it no longer has information about the flow variables because of this characteristic wave. For hyperbolic problems, hyperbolic means you have two characteristic waves, right? If you remember characteristics of PDE, hyperbolic equations are two real and distinct characteristic waves across which the flow solution exists. Okay. Characteristic waves are nothing but the wave solution is the solution is different ahead and beyond this shock wave. Okay, so that's the physical, I would say, numerical explanation of CFL condition. So we have seen that on called as consistency. We said that when we write the truncation series, if your delta x and delta t are tending to zero, then that is like 2 minute delta x, that is delta t to the power of say 1000 and delta x to the power of 1000 and so on. And if your differential equation, whatever you get, is truncation error is going very, very small, that means that the solution is okay. It is reaching the exact solution, but we know that we also have additional errors coming from because of the rounding off errors. Whenever we code the CFD algorithms, we end up with rounding off errors, and even if this rounding off errors are also going, say we cannot set delta t and delta x zero. But for given delta t and delta x, if you run for, say, millions of iterations, for steady state problems at least, say 10 power minus 20 is your error. Okay. So what happens is your solution will match the exact solution. That's what we have seen in your explicit and implicit codes. The solution is matching almost exactly with the exact solution. Your numerical solution is matching with your exact solution. That's what we have seen. Okay. In the Python notebooks that I have demonstrated, if you set your error to be much lower, it's going to take more number of iterations and the solution will be much more close to the exact solution. So a scheme has to be consistent and stable for it to be accepted as a good scheme. So one other important thing is, if a scheme is consistent and stable, okay, it is going to converge. Converge simply means that you are going to get your numerical solution that you get from your CFD will match with your exact solution. Okay, I think it's the same code, explicit and implicit codes that we have seen, and 1D unsteady heat equation codes that we have seen. We see that the solution is nicely matching with the exact solution because the scheme was consistent, and also when we took delta t as something greater than 0.5 in the explicit code, it was blowing, it was unstable, and hence it was not converging to the solution. So there are three conditions to be met if you develop any new scheme, or you have to check for the consistency and stability. Okay, Peter Lacks also suggested a theorem called as equivalence theorem. He said that if a scheme is consistent and stable, it is bound to be convergent. You are going to get good results. So if you check just for these two conditions, first condition always matches. Okay. because we are using Taylor series, and as delta t and delta x tend to 0, the truncation error always tends to 0. If we are doing something else apart from Taylor series, say other polynomials, we have to be sure that these things, this truncation error tends to 0 when we take a large number of terms. Okay. And we have to check for stability. Stability must be demonstrated. Okay, so that's what Peter-Lax equivalence theorem is. That's what we have seen in the last class. Okay, this is a simple figure which encapsulates whatever we have discussed. So if you discretize a governing equation, you are going to get a set of linear algebraic equations or a system of linear equations. Then when you if you solve these governing equations directly using analytical methods, you are going to get exact solution. Okay, normally for simple problems you can get exact solution, just like what we have seen for the one dimensional unsteady heat diffusion equation. Okay, so when you solve the system of linear equations and you check for the stability, you are going to get some, under stability limits you are going to get some approximate solution or the numerical solution. And as this delta x delta tend, delta t tend to 0, that is if you take very very large grids and very very small time steps, okay, your delta x will be very small and your delta t will be very small. In those cases, your approximate solution will tend to the exact solution. So you are going to get much more closer to our exact solution. So that's what we have seen. So simply put, Peter-Lax theorem is consistency plus stability will usually end up in convergence. Okay, so that's what we have seen. We have seen in detail what this stability analysis is and how it looks in the real world, at least for the two governing equations that we have seen. For the problems, advection is very important. So your delta t, whichever is minimum, you choose between these two. Okay, we have seen alpha delta t over delta x square should be less than or equal to half for your heat diffusion equation. So similarly, instead of alpha, you are going to get mu, viscosity, because viscosity is a diffusive effect. Okay, so your flow physics, your governing equations and your numerical scheme, you have to have a grip or good understanding of all these three areas for you to use appropriate algorithms or even implement them. Okay, so progression so far, there is one more topic that is left out in our in this chapter, called as alternating direction method. Okay, it's alternating direction implicit method. Okay, this is simply the extension of what we have seen of the Crank-Nicholson scheme or the implicit method. Okay, just like in the Crank-Nicholson scheme, let me open this one. Okay. So just like in the 1D equation, we have taken only this term. This term alpha delta t dou square t by dou x square. Now we are going to consider this equation in two dimensions, and we are going to take the derivative in y direction as well. So when you apply this forward difference, forward in time and central in space, I'll tell you why we have to take central in space. Generally, second order derivatives, we end up with second when we, because for the stencil to be balanced, okay, for the stencil to be you have to give equal weight to points on both the sides for diffusion based problems. Okay, because the behavior is elliptic, that is this information is going to, the diffusion is going to take place physical directions. If you diffusion, for example, if you put a bottle of perfume in one room, okay, that perfume, you after you maybe there is no air current traveling in this room, you come after half an hour and you can smell this perfume in all directions in the room. That is, this perfume has diffused in all directions equally. Okay, so that's what diffusion is. That's why we have to take, say, information at point I as well as information at I minus 1 and I plus 1. We don't take I plus 1 and I, okay? Because diffusion physically is traveling in both directions. So let's apply the central scheme. That's why we, whenever we are talking about diffusion-based problems, we always use central scheme. Okay. Now we are going to approximate dou square t by dou x. We are using second derivative approximation using central difference. What we are going to get is 1 by delta x square t I plus 1 minus 2 t I plus t I minus 1. Okay, we also have the j as well, because it's a two-dimensional function. Temperature is varying in both space, two dimensions in space as well as in time. So what we have done in the Kranke-Nicholson scheme is we have simply averaged t I plus 1 is at nth time step is nothing but it's an average of n plus 1 time step and nth time step. So we have to substitute these three values here. That's what we have done. And we get this term finally, 1 by 2 delta x square. So we have this term, these three terms in n plus 1 time step and these three terms at nth time step. We have done it multiple times, even in your exam, most of you have done it. I think even in the assignment, I hope. So we have to consider the second term as well. If you look at the second term, we get similar term, but only thing is the index j is varying. I get tj plus 1 minus 2tj plus tji minus 1. So the stencil looks like this. I have I plus 1 point here, I comma j plus 1, I comma j minus 1, I minus 1 comma j, I plus 1 comma j. So these are the, this is my stencil. So this is I comma j, okay, I cannot write. Okay, this is I comma j and this is I plus 1 comma j. Okay, this is ith line. And this is I plus 1, so let me remove it. Okay, this is I plus 1 and this is I minus 1. This is in y direction, this is j minus 1, this is j and this is j plus 1. So in the x direction, I get t I comma j, that is t I plus 1 comma j minus 1. Minus 2t ij my plus 2j I minus 1. This is the x stencil and this is the y stencil. So this is my stencil. Stencil is nothing but all the points that I use in my discretization should be, it can be diagrammatically represented in this fashion. So what happens is if you take this first term and plug it in here and you take the second term and you plug it in here, what you are going to end up is, you are going to end up in a pentadiagonal system because you have five unknowns here, okay? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, okay? This Tij n plus 1 is common here, here and in the LHS. So we are going to get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 unknowns in this equation. If you remember in the one-dimensional unsteady heat diffusion equation, when you apply the implicit method, you got three unknowns. Now we have got five unknowns. So we end up with a pentadiagonal system where you have a matrix like this. You have a diagonal term and two upper diagonals with non-zeros and two lower diagonals and rest will be zero. Okay. Instead of just one non-zero upper diagonal elements, you get two non-zero upper diagonal elements. Okay. Unfortunately, for this, we cannot use the Thomas algorithm. Thomas algorithm is one of the most efficient methods of solving this linear system in structured problems. We cannot use Thomas algorithm. But there is a way of reducing this system to solving two TDMAs. Two tridiagonal systems can be solved. Okay. This pentadiagonal can be reduced into application of two times the tridiagonal algorithm. Okay, we'll see how. What we can do is we can split this step. Okay, we can split this step into two components. First, what we will do is we will say that we are, instead of going from t to t plus delta t, that is n to n plus 1, let's go from n to n plus half, or t to t plus delta t over 2. Okay, so what we are going to get is, let's say we are going to solve only for x derivatives of temperature, that is only varying in the x direction. So what we get here is, instead of n plus 1, I get n plus half. Okay, let me apply the Kranz-Nicholson method at n plus half step. So what I get here is, only in the x direction, n plus half unknowns, and y I am not going to change. Y will be only treated explicitly. So what I end up with is, I get a tridiagonal system at n plus half. At n plus half. Okay, ki will be now k will be now these terms plus whatever terms are coming. Only these terms. Okay, these terms. So what I end up with is, I end up with only three unknowns in my equation. I am getting temperature at n plus half time step. Only x derivative terms are treated implicitly. Okay, now that is the first step. Okay, that is the first step that we have seen. Next, we'll go from t delta t by 2 to delta t. Okay, now what we can do is, now we'll solve it. Okay, this is only plus. I think this is something from my notes. Okay, so next step, we know temperature at n plus half. We know the temperature at n plus half time step, because we have already solved using the Thomas algorithm. And now we have to now treat the y derivative terms, spatial derivative terms, implicitly. So what we get here is LHS, we get n plus half 1 here, and n plus half are all known. These four terms are known, n plus half terms are known, and RHS, these are the unknowns. We don't know this term. So again, we end up with a tridiagonal system in the y direction. Okay, you can see here that the y indices, that is j, is changing, and here only the I indices are changing, I minus 1, I plus 1. Okay, first we solve in x, then we solve in y. So that's why first step, what we have done is, we went from t to t plus delta t over 2, then again t plus delta t over 2 to t plus delta t. So it's a two-step process. The advantage of this step is, so what we are doing is, we are alternating direction. First we have solved in x, then we are solving it in y. That's why it's called as alternating direction implicit method. It simplifies our system of linear equations. If you are going for 3D, you are going to get, instead of pentadiagonal, you are going to get what? 7 unknowns. You have 2 more unknowns in the z direction, and you are going to get heptadiagonal system of linear equations. In that case also, you can use ADI. You can split it into a 3-step process, and you can happily solve your linear system at every stage using Thomas algorithm. So to employ Thomas algorithm, which is the cheapest possible method, and to reduce the storage. So whatever matrices you are using here can be reused here, and can be reused in the z direction. So you are saving memory, you are being computationally efficient, and you are solving this in 3 steps. Okay, so these are the coefficients that you get for this matrices and your RHS. So you end up alternating between the directions in an implicit way. So that's about it. This is the last topic in this chapter, and next we are going to go to the next chapter, which is based on mesh grid generation, grids. What do we know about grids, and how do we understand grids? What are the different types of grids, and so on. So we are going to look at all the details. Any questions so far in this chapter? Okay, according to the syllabus, we have finished module 1. We have thoroughly completed module 2. Okay, next, module 3, discretization. And finally, finite difference method in detail. We have completed all these things, implicit, semi-implicit, ADA methods, stability analysis and error estimation, so on. Maybe I'll just, next class, I'll just give a note on the difference between implicit and semi-implicit, but that's not a big thing. But we are going to start grid generation, the module 4, okay? We are going to learn what is a grid, how it looks like, what are different types of arrangements, and so on. What are the different types of grids that we can use in CFD, etc. Okay, any questions so far? Okay, maybe I'll ask post attendance at this point. Okay, posted the attendance. Please answer the attendance. And I believe someone has asked me a question. Let me check. Will you, sir, will you be uploading all these pages? Yes, I will be uploading these PDF files and these pages. If you have any questions, you can get back to me in any class. I can clear your doubts. I have to correct this notice, correct the other PDF. I have to give the plus sign there. I'll change that and I'll post the PDFs. If you're unable to access the form, just make sure that you punch in your registration number here in the chat. Okay, next we'll look at grid generation. I'll give you a brief introduction for tomorrow's class. Hopefully we'll finish it off in one or two classes like today and tomorrow. Okay. So I told you, right, maybe in the lab session, that grid generation is one of the most important components in CFD. You have experts who only do grid generation. Okay, there are people who just sit around the whole day and create grids. So that's how important it is. For especially for complex geometries, it is really, really difficult to generate grids. And your solutions quality will be heavily dependent on your grids. Okay, that's why you have to, you cannot just, you know, just like maybe in structural solvers, you can simply generate any grid and you would get away with it. But not in CFD. CFD is very, very sensitive to your grid, and you have to take a lot of parameters or aspects into account when you're generating a grid and when you're trying to solve. Your grid should be almost perfect for your, we have enough problems in our CFD solvers. They are very, very sensitive to truncation errors and so on. If you, even if your grid is also not wrong, this stability analysis and your CFL numbers, you have to reduce your CFL number if your grid is not good. Then you have to spend a lot of time solving these problems, etc. So there will be heavy penalties in your CFD solvers if your grid is not good. Okay. You can see here that most of the engineering problems involve complex grids. Here you can see on the top right side, I think it's a Francis turbine where we where someone has created a nice grid, which is consisting of hexahedral elements, that is six cubes or cuboids over different turbine blades. Turbine blades and how do you say, propellers, and you know, when you look at the full body of aircraft or rockets, etc., these are some of the most complex geometries that you can come across, because you have sharp turns. And the profile is quite important. You need to get the profile right, etc. And also a car body, you can see on the top right corner, bottom right corner, that it's a three-dimensional model of a car. you can imagine here, apart from the body and the wheels, you can also plug in your rear view windows, maybe your antenna, etc. So for racing cars, especially NASCARs and Ferrari, that F1 racing, aerodynamics is heavily very very important. Aerodynamics is very important. Okay, you must be knowing, some of you must maybe knowing, that your F1 car is an inverted aerofoil. Okay, because if it is moving at hundreds of kilometers per hour speed, it can simply lift off the ground. So to help it stick it to the ground, what they do is they take an aerofoil. What an aerofoil does is it generates lift. Okay, so it will go up if the fluid's velocity is increasing. They will just invert the they will just reverse the aerofoil or wing, and they will design these F1 cars based on that. So what happens is the car will not simply fly away, but it will just stick to the road. Okay, even if the road is inverted, like in a roller coaster, the car is not going to fall off. So that's the suction level or suction power that car has because of the aerodynamics. So the aerodynamics plays a heavy role, especially the fuel efficiency of aircrafts, fuel efficiency of cars, how much fuel they're consuming, etc., etc. All these things are very, very dependent on your aerodynamics and flow features. Okay, so your grid should be, so whenever you're trying to solve such kind of problems, your grid should be very, very clean and very much palatable, or your CFD solver should be very, very happy with your grid. Okay, so there are lots of things to consider when we are going into grid generation. First is choice of grid. Okay, you can see here that I have shown here a structured grid, Cartesian grids we call it. Cartesian grids are nothing but you have so you can see here on the right hand side, rectangular grid, right? You have I equals to 1, I equals to 2, I equals to 3 lines, and j equals to 1, j equals to 3, and so on, some say 50 or 100 lines. So you have I lines and j lines, which are orthogonal to each other, okay, in the xyz. So these I lines are parallel to your x axis, and j lines are parallel to your y axis. So they are perpendicular to each other. You can also have these I lines inclined at 45 degrees, and j lines are also at 90 degrees, and they are inclined at 135 degrees to your x axis. So even in those cases, you will have orthogonal lines. Orthogonal means these I lines and J lines are at 90 degrees. They intersect at 90 degrees to each other. You can have a similar orthogonal grid for flow over a cylinder. You can see here that your I lines are, they are in the R theta coordinate system or polar system or spherical coordinate system, where your R theta Z and your R theta coordinate system, they are also orthogonal to each other. Okay, these lines intersect at 90 degrees. If you look closely, they will be intersecting at 90 degrees. So these grids are also Cartesian. That is, your I lines and J lines, if they are cutting each other at 90 degrees, we end up with a Cartesian grid. Okay, this is the most ideal form of a grid. But unfortunately, just like in real life, we cannot generate these grids whenever we want. Okay, for complicated geometries, we simply cannot generate these grids. Okay, so you can see these lines are straight lines, and these are curvilinear lines. That is, they have a curvature to them. They have a slope to them, which is changing in space. But still, these lines are orthogonal to each other, like in different directions. You can also use, you can represent these geometries either in structured way or unstructured way. Okay, structured grids and unstructured grids are structured grids, you can store them as structured grid or unstructured grid. Okay, but since they are orthogonal to each other, all your CFD algorithms will work very, very nicely, because as you can see, as you have looked at the ADI scheme, you have cleanly separated the a progression in x direction and y direction. But life is never so easy. As you can see here, we have non-orthogonal grid. Okay, these triangles are not orthogonal to each other at the boundaries. Okay, they're not at 90 degrees to each other. They're at some other degrees. It's less than maybe 60 degrees. Inside the domain, we have all these triangles are looking like equilateral triangles. They're at 60 degrees to each other. And at the boundary, we see that these triangles are at some oblique angles or acute angles to each other. So we have a non-orthogonal grid made up of triangles. And this data structure can only be represented as unstructured. So you, just like you have I equals to 1, I comma j 1 comma 10 point, you can figure out what it is. Here you cannot represent your triangles in an orderly fashion. That is, you cannot pinpoint and say, okay, this is my fifth point and, fifth point in X and 10th point in Y. You cannot do that because the order is changing. Okay. So mostly, so that's what we'll be looking at. First, what is the type of grid that we need to take? Should we take a regular grid or a structured grid, or we should we take an unstructured grid with non-orthogonal elements or unstructured grid with orthogonal elements, etc., etc. We'll look at all these things in the next class. That is tomorrow's class. So we'll look at it. If you have any questions, you can ask me now. If you're unable to ask, you can also type in the chat window. Okay, that's fine then. Then we'll continue this topic in the next class, grid generation. Hopefully, we'll finish it off in tomorrow's class. Yeah. Any other questions? Okay, then I'll see you guys in tomorrow's class. I think we have.
Excuse me, sir. I submitted my attendance a little late, sir. I had very less internet, sir. But I was there from the start.
Okay, just pop in your attendance registration number in the chat window. Okay then, if no other queries, we'll meet in tomorrow's class. I think it's at the same time. Someone else has...
Sir, tomorrow which timetable, sir?
I believe it's Friday's timetable. I think it's Friday's timetable. That is same, just like today. We're going to have a class. I hope you got an email regarding it, isn't it?
I got a long time. I had forgotten that, sir.
Okay, fine.
Let me check. Sir, I messaged you regarding the 26th August theory attendance.
Yeah, I'll post.
Look into that before it gets blocked.
Okay, I'll look into that.
Yes, sir.
Okay, tomorrow it is, what is the date tomorrow? 29th, right? Yeah, it's Friday's class tomorrow. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Sir, I just put the attendance in the chat box because I'm not sure if it was submitted or not. Just
sure.
Thank you, sir.
All right. I'll see you guys tomorrow then.
Thank you, sir.